that many people can do that. But it's certainly worth striving towards.
So we're going to be talking today about how to create a great solo simply by identifying what you like in somebody else's solo and applying that to your own playing. So I've constructed this list over the years by just writing down different techniques that I hear when I hear a great soloist like Michael Brecker. And you can apply this to any player. And he just happens to be one of my absolute favorites because he always manages to incorporate numerous aspects of a solo, which make it interesting. And then I did a blog on this subject about a year ago because I'd seen this really interesting graphic on Facebook. And I think it was intended to be a joke, but really, if you followed this, it would really add to the development of your solo as well.
So lots of stuff going on in there. One chord. Yeah, they started out with, you know, some of those crazy chords happening at the beginning, but then it just settles in and it's F7. And he makes a lot of that, right? One chord, and he played many different things. And if you look on that sheet, he pretty much covers all of this. So when you're listening to a solo and going, man, is that great, you know, add to this list or highlight some of these that you feel are very cool and resonate with you. Because you'll notice, yeah, Brecker uses space. He's unique characteristics of the instrument, right? So trills. And then he quickly moves into medium intensity, meaning it's starting to build, and he plays some really intense melodic phrases that aren't just kind of blues scale. They're getting inside the harmony and a lot of chromatic type licks and short little phrases. Beat up, beat up, beat up, beat up. And that creates tension, and that starts moving the solo forward, and we're excited. We can't wait to hear what's coming next. So then he always manages to make it into a frenzy, and this solo just totally exemplifies that. He's got tremendous technique in order to get up into that really high range, right? But he's so awesome at playing super low, then not too long later playing super high. And he's doing lots of fast flourishes. Coltrane, right? Coltrane was one of his main influences. And then he'll also just do something really repetitive, and that's the thing you see a lot of sax players do, a lot of guitar players, and it's really effective. So no matter what you play, I play trombone, I try to do some of that because it's really a powerful tool to try to build your solo to a real intense, exciting point, and then boom, the bottom drops out, next solo. I'm going to put the link down there so you can go buy this recording if you don't have it. Let's listen to that solo again, and I'll point out when I feel he's doing one of these low intensity, medium intensity, high intensity. So right away you're hearing his sound, right? He has effects on his sound. Weave it in and out of those changes. That was pretty intense. Boom. Already he's playing something really high, but now it just kind of brings it down. Repetitive. Not trying to do too much. A little trill. Now he's getting medium intensity. Repetitive. Playing a different area of the horn. Serious chromaticism. Now he's high. And he's going to repeat that with a slightly different rhythm. Do this hemiola. That's all about rhythm. And most people can't do that because of the range he's playing that in. So impressive. Coltrane lick, bobby dum bada. Changes with the chords, down at whole steps. So that's a pattern. Okay, but he brings us back, right? We can understand this, the rhythm section's joining in. Okay, now I want something more. Starts playing wrong notes. Now he's back up super high. Listen to the rhythm section. Totally about rhythm. Higher chromatic. And then he's going to release it here. And now give us a little bit more. And then he joins in on the last lick. How awesome is that? So there's so much information in that one solo, and you shouldn't necessarily make it your mission that you have to transcribe that whole thing. But it is really beneficial to just notice some of those techniques, and you can put it in your own solo, in your own way, on your own instrument. I certainly can't play that, but I certainly have studied and listened to him a lot, and I would like to think some of those elements are in my own playing. And what's so cool about being a musician is you don't then just only have to study Michael Brecker, but you can check out anybody you like, and it doesn't have to even just be jazz. You know, if you like what Harry Connick is kind of a little bit of a crossover thing, right? Or if you really love Van Halen's solo on Eruption, check that out. Put some of those elements in your solo, and you'll quickly see that your solos, at very least, take a different direction. And it's really an exciting journey, and it never ends. So I'll do more of these videos on this type of subject, because it can really get all of us involved, because I'm interested in hearing what you guys have to say and your thoughts about this subject, because it's really exciting. So check this out. Give me a shout if you have questions about things. Send me a video of you playing a solo, and we'll connect again soon.